First annual debate between Muhammad Al-Sarif and Julian Sprung. We'll be talking about Mideast peace policy. Jake Adams. I haven't seen him for a while. And Julian Sprung, and we're going to be debating refugiums, the pros, the cons, and everything in between. We have Jake Adams for the against side. Julian, he's kind of ambiguous, right? But kind of for, but kind of against, but kind of...
I would say I'm on the side.
I guess we'll find out with your presentation. All right, so the ground rules are Julian's going to go first, and then Jake is going to go, and then I'll proclaim Julian the winner. So that's how it's going to roll. After we get done, I might have a few questions. If you guys have any questions, I'll go out in the audience. And you guys can ask your questions to Julian, to Jake. And at the end, we declare a winner. And the winner gets what? $500. So we'll be taking a offering a little bit later for the pool. So get your wallets out. And so without further ado, by the way, I'm Mitch. Nice to meet you. If you think I'm funny, come to the gig for the MC banquet, or I'll be absolutely atrocious. All right, so, Julian, you're up.
I think you said you wanted me to go first?
That's correct.
Okay, just a moment. So, I'll go first. You
that's
said little, it was
that's
the
a
rules.
Little preview of my humor for the MC banquet,
yeah.
So that's okay. About what it's going to be.
Okay. Well, hi, everybody. No booze and hissing, none of that. When Jake told me about the MACNA conference and that he wanted me to come and do a presentation, and then he said, you know, I've got it. I want to get up there and debate you on refugiums. I thought, you want to do what? I thought, I didn't even realize there was an opposing point of view on that. Let me think about that. Let me think about that for a moment. And that, you know, I sure wish that I could have taken the time to stop doing what I do every day and really, you know, get into this and make this even more fun than it is. It's going to be fun, don't get me wrong. I certainly didn't want to get into a mudslinging affair. And you'll see that I cover some important points. And bottom line, I being put in the position of thinking about not having a refugium, it opened my mind to something. And I thought, yeah, you know, there really is an opposing point of view. And so then the question I had was, what can be learned from it? And so you're going to see, it's not going to be no, you're stupid if you don't have a refugium on your tank or whatever like that. So this is going to be an interesting talk. I start on my side with a refugium is not what you think. By the way, those of you who say refugium, come on. Refugium. Say you, few. Okay, what is a refugium? If you look it up, Google the word refugium, or you look in the dictionary. It's an area special environmental circumstances enable a species or a community of species to survive after extinction in the general environment. So if you think about that in application to our aquariums, it's sort of a little safe zone. Now, we have a term fuge for what we do with our aquariums, and it's a little bit longer, more complicated definition. A separate, smaller aquarium plumbed together with your main display tank, often used for deep sand beds, for growing caulerpa or ketomorpha, for the purpose of nutrient export, for taking out nitrate, phosphate, as well as for balancing oxygen levels, pH levels, especially when you use reverse daylight photosynthesis. So another function of the refugium is to provide a refuge for small benthic animals that people call critters or bugs and pods. because your fish are predators, they eat these things in the main display tank, and they can't wipe them out in the refugium, and the pods reproduce in the refugium, and the water flows back to the display tank, replenishing populations. So this is the more complex description, following the same idea of a refugium. So I wrote an article about this in a Japanese magazine, and I just used that as my illustration. In and out, that's the idea, connected aquarium. Now, maybe there's other sorts of refugiums. Think about this. Now, you really have to analyze it, and Jake's bringing this subject up, it gave me a little pause to think about it. How do you distinguish a separate aquarium from a separate zone within the main display tank? Do refugiums only exist in a separate aquarium when, you know, plumb to another? So other examples, I believe, a filter chamber in your all-in-one tank. You don't have to have a sump in a refugium. Hang on the back refugium. CPR has made those for many years. Even Joubert's plenum filter, think about it, that body of water and the water in the sand, they are examples of refugium. Hey, if you got plumbing on your tank, you got a refugium. Biofilms, other creatures are living in those biofilms, your fish are not going to go, well, not usually. They don't usually go in the plumbing, and when they do, they're not looking for food. So there's a lot of things that will live in a refugium that is a separate tank that will also live in your plumbing. So it's hard to escape a refugium. A pump is a refugium. Is it not? Is live rock a refugium? Well, yes, of course, to some extent it is. Isn't any biological filter a refugium? If you're flowing the water through it and the fish aren't going in there, other predators aren't going, there's a lot of life in there. It's not just bacteria. There's copepods, there's worms, there's other stuff in there. Sponges you may find in your filter. So can you really say that a reef aquarium has no refugium? Hey, what about coral, a piece of coral? Is a coral a refugium for zooxanthellae and for other creatures that live in its skeleton or on its body? Okay, what is natural? People talk about refugium filters as being natural filtration. You know, when we think about natural, we think of this omniscient being imagining things and making them, you know, this way. Or if we think of Mother Nature. And when we talk about filtration as aquarists, we tend to divide it. You know, divide the darkness from the lightness, biology versus technology, bacteria versus algae, algae versus higher plants, and then the zooxanthellae and our corals. You know, it all works. They're all part of the natural ecosystem, and they're part of our aquariums because we're keeping them live unless we have everything dead and sterile. So, you know, looking at some different tanks that you can see online in some of the Tank of the Month forums, here was an interesting example of kind of like a zeovit-type tank where you have a low nutrient zone, high flow, and SPS corals. And this is not typically a tank that's got a refugium. It's typically got either zeovit method and heavy protein skimming. This is a method that works, okay? Jake, on the other hand, distilled the idea of maintaining corals to the bare essence. I mean, the only way you could make this any simpler is remove the glass and the water, right? So, Eco Reef Zero. No filter, nothing. Well, yeah, there's a filter. The zooxanthellae affect the water, and the coral does have a skeleton, which is like live rock. Jake made this system, too. And technically a giant clam refugium. Is this natural? Well, yeah, apparently so. This is a photograph in, where is that, Micronesia, where there are places where there are, you know, reefs that are made entirely of Tridacna maxima, and a lot of these beautiful ultra-blue clams are coming from that region now. It's amazing. It's natural. You can utilize not only plants for filtering your water in a refugium, you can use zinnia. They're fast-growing soft corals. Sponges live in the sand bed, and that's a refugium for them. If there was a sponge-eating fish in that tank, the sponge could still live in between the sand grains, and it's protected. Now, sponges filter the water, and sand beds filter the water, and I'm not going to waste the time getting into this whole natural filtration that occurs on a coral reef, but it does. You can look this up online on how the coral mucus gets advected through the sand grains. Sponges on natural reefs filter a tremendous amount of the water. That black area over the reef in profile there, that's showing the amount of water in a 24-hour period filtered by the sponges in Discovery Bay, Jamaica. So they're not just filter feeders, they also have nitrifying bacteria living in them. So sponges are their own little biological filters, and you can read about this in peer-reviewed journals on coral reef biology. If you go diving on a coral reef, you will notice a difference between our reef tanks and nature. If you look on the undersides of ledges, and then even especially in the Caribbean, out in the open, high, high diversity, tremendous amount of sponges. They are effective filters. But I'm swaying or just straying from the topic here. Steve Tyree set up Refugium filters that employed sponges. So, you know, Jake, I don't know, did that end up in the, I didn't see the show book yet. It did? So Jake had said, you know, hey, why set up a display tank and, you know, pretend, you know, you could set up a display tank for little creatures, and why do you need to connect it to your reef? And I say, you know, that would mean a separate pump and auto top-off system. So another benefit of having a refugium is you can support your habit. Come on, let's be honest. We want more and more tanks, and you can do that without having more and more pumps. You can also create separate special types of aquariums, such as a deep reef refugium that you can feed a lot of food to. It doesn't need to be as big as your main display. Tubastrea refugium. How about a jellyfish refugium? You know, jellyfish aquariums are now becoming popular, but, you know, you don't have to be held to filtering the aquarium within the jellyfish aquarium. You can connect it to your display. Now, I'm not going to talk about whether nematocysts are going to affect your other creatures in the display. There's many types of jellyfish that could be in a jellyfish refugium. So where did this begin in our hobby, this topic? Well, Walter Ady is the guy. He's Mr. Refugium, and he talked about, he really brought that word to the consciousness of the aquarium hobby. And he did so in this book, Dynamic Aquaria. Algal turf filters, they are refugia themselves, although they tend to develop microherbivores that will graze them down if you don't maintain the turf properly. And there's a turf scrubber refugium that Walter Ady developed. Some hobbyists have built vertical turf scrubbers. There's many types of ways to employ algae. Refugium sumps, this is something that was promoted in a big way by Lang Tsai, who's sitting here in the audience. See him right there. The use of caulerpa and mud to promote the growth of caulerpa. This is a beneficial filtration method. It's called a natural filtration method. And it's not very technical, not very sophisticated. It's quite easy to set up. There's a lot of different species of caulerpa we can use. And there are other types of algae that will grow in a refugium. Ketomorpha also is quite popular in a refugium. And algae, by the way, are not just for filtration. You can have a refugium on a fish-only tank and use the algae as food and recycle it. Algae are delicious. How about a plankton refugium? The Zinn reactor, which was described many years ago online. You can have a slow flow from your aquarium through an ultraviolet sterilizer and feed the nutrients from your aquarium into a phytoplankton filter, and the phytoplankton can feed zooplankton, and that can then supply zooplankton back to your tank. It's a little bit complex to set up, but it's theoretically possible. Refugiums as planted marine displays, that's possible as well, and I think quite beautiful. Seagrasses as well as animals to keep, or animals, as plants to keep in the refugium, along with creatures like seahorses, which don't really work in a reef tank with high flow. Seagrasses like Thalassia are best started from propagules like that. mangrove refugiums. Mangroves are very effective filters. If you have enough of them, or if you have a large enough mangrove, they really do impact the nitrate and phosphate levels. One or two pods, it's irrelevant. They don't. But over time, or if you have a large number of them, they can filter the water. And there are a number of them available to hobbyists. So there's a display tank in our office, and look at that. Is that a refugium or is it a display tank? And it's connected to a refugium that's also a display tank. And so the line is sort of blurry here. What is what? Are there any negative effects of refugiums? Can a refugium be a source of undesirable things in our aquarium? Can a coral tank be managed in exclusivity of refugia? Is yours the next slide, Jay? I think. Or what are the benefits to be gained by running a system without a refugium? I think you're next. Okay.
Well, I'm convinced. Thanks, Julian.
You're welcome. Yeah.
I don't know about you guys, but I really don't need to hear what Jake says. So.
Yeah. So long.
Thanks, Julian, and
I'm still in the game.
You're still going to talk.
Yeah.
Sorry, folks. Jake's still going to talk, I guess. So here's the other counterpoint. Not that we need to hear it, but here it goes.
I have to go again.
I just want to thank all of you guys for coming to my hometown of Denver. It's such a treat to have a say in what's happening in the show. And thank you very much, Julian, for entertaining this this interesting presentation format. And thank you, Mitch, for doing what it is that you do. I've been running around a lot at the show, and there's a part of me that wanted to tell Mitch to go easy on me, but I knew that anything I said would be held against me and used against me, so I just let him do his thing. One thing that's really interesting about the presentation that Julian gave is when I first foresaw this presentation coming, I thought it would be a classical for refugiums, classical against refugiums. And one of the things I wanted to do was to pick apart what a refugium really, really means. And he kind of really, pulled the rug out from under my feet in a way, so I have to continue with my train of thought, but take some different angles. So, the fact that we're having this debate means we've both already won. We're both just getting you to think about what it is you do in your tank and why. So to begin, I think refugiums are a distraction. I'm really all about corals and fish and the macro life that we keep. We spend the majority of our time talking about coral species, coral requirements, fish species, fish requirements, and then way, way, way down we talk about invertebrates. Unless you're talking to Julian, who's mildly infatuated with mangroves and seagrasses and caulerpas. 99% of the airtime, the reef aquarium hobby, is happening about corals and fish. And so when people set up a refugium, I really think it's a distraction. This is, more or less what we all want to see in our aquariums. Very few of us set up a reef tank, see a coral reef aquarium, and say, oh, I want a really junky looking tank of plants and algae and sand right next to it.
Good one.
So when someone is looking into getting a reef and coral aquarium for the first time, they're overwhelmed by an avalanche of information that is available to properly set up a reef aquarium. A prospective new aquarist is assaulted with so many choices and the details of water chemistry, water testing, complicated devices, different lighting colors, a laundry list of necessary equipment. And refugiums become part of that laundry list if somebody's selling a refugium sump, or if you see the hobbyist down the road has a refugium and you think you have to have one of those. And they're told that supposedly this is the best way to go because especially the modern incarnation of a refugium is an all-in-one amalgamation of a few different ideas that have kind of been polluted over the years. The refugium that Julian discussed, which is a refuge for certain things, is something that I'm completely for, but that is not what the majority of you have in your tanks or with the products that are available to support them nowadays. So these are some reasons to set up a refugium that I pulled off the Live Aquaria website. And you would think that with refugiums, you know, tanks would magically just happen. So a refugium is provides aquarium habitants with natural food sources such as phytoplankton and zooplankton, right? No one can disagree. Filter water naturally by dramatically lowering nitrates and phosphate levels. It stabilizes water conditions, especially pH and oxygen. It helps control algae growth. And it adds trace elements into the existing aquarium water. In certain cases, when you set up a refugium properly, you can get some of these benefits. But if the refugiums work so well, why do we have phytoplankton and zooplankton foods? Why do we have biopellet reactors and biopellets for natural nitrate and phosphate control? Why do we use protein skimmers for nutrient export, pH and oxygen regulation? Why do we have a gazillion different trace additives to add to our tanks, right? Because from the slide before, a refugium does all of these things. So why are we still doing adding all these things to our aquarium? And the reason is because the way that refugiums are currently set up, they don't really work to provide those services because they've all been put together and kind of polluted. So this is a typical all-in-one refugium right here. And this is not what refugiums looked like 20 years ago. This refugium has a pre-protein skimmer, which is not too bad, and it has a macroalgae scrubber with a sand bed. If you want a refugium, an all-in-one refugium, CPR has done a really, really good job. There's some other acrylic manufacturers that do a good job, but this is a mess. This is a lot of different things happening together between the live rock, the algae, and the sand bed. So one of the things that's been incorporated into the refugiums is the idea of an algae scrubber. Now, an algae scrubber is supposed to be a very specific device that's meant to grow algae. And to have a really good algae scrubber, you need to have high flow, high light, good water turnover, and specific species of algae. Like Julian mentioned, if you don't take care of it properly in an algae turf scrubber situation, you get microherbivores that eat it as well and just re-export that waste right back in your tank. You can't really export microalgae from a refugium as well as you can from a turf scrubber, especially in a refugium area because those nutrients are just being recycled and put back into the water. This is another example of a screen algae turf scrubber. Now on paper, in theory, the refugium is, like Julian mentioned, a saltwater planted aquarium. You know, we think about having a refugium and it's gonna be this beautiful place, this magical garden where all the pods grow and everything lives in harmony and you have a beautiful sand bed and fields of multicolored algae. In some cases, you can get kind of close. You can have a deep, nice sand bed, some filtering algae, some macroalgae, and you can get that pretty look. But raise your hand if your refugium looks like that. I don't think so. Most oftentimes, what you end up is an unsightly mess. This is not even the worst picture I pulled off live. This is kind of middle of the road. And like Julian mentioned, a lot of people will set up a refugium because, let's be honest, you know, we want to maximize our hobby. We want to, you know, have that spouse factor to, oh, no, honey, I have to have this tank in line with the aquarium. You know, but it's under the pretenses of making your primary exhibit nicer. You know, this is also a really typical sump area, and you'll grow a lot of diatoms, and that prevents the sand bed from functioning properly. So not only do most refugium look completely unpresentable, like that, trying to provide an area that blends all these concepts is it's a common denominator, lowest common denominator that doesn't help your refugium aspects that you want, doesn't help with the turf scrubber algae processes that you want, it doesn't help with the sand bed processes that you want. A bona fide algae scrubber, whether it's macro or micro, should have strong lighting, strong water flow, and strong agitation to thoroughly flush the algae. A sand bed should be unlit so that algae doesn't grow on the sand bed, and we know that light interferes with bacterial processes. And a sand bed should have pretty good, adequate water flow moving over it. Not enough to stir up the sand, but enough to keep a thorough water exchange going over it. These biological methods for providing functions in reef tanks, they can work. They really, really can, under the best of circumstances, as I just outlined. But algae turf scrubbers, algae scrubbers, and sand beds are not compatible in the current way that we are using them. But my main point is that you simply don't need a refugium to enjoy corals and reef fish. In fact, more modern aquarium displays, the most successful aquarium displays, they don't necessarily use a refugium. All you need is good aquarium husbandry, good practices, don't overstock your tank, don't overfeed your fish, and you know, really let bacteria do the work. I really think that with more understanding of bacteria, we can have much, much cleaner tanks. And that's another one of the things with the refugium. It's supposed to have this huge surface area for bacteria to grow, but we really don't take into account all the surfaces of our aquariums, all of the surfaces of the glass, the surfaces of the sump. There's so much surface area there that we don't need to pack our tank full of live rocks or refugiums to get that algae, that biological action going. On the flip side, a lot of refugiums actually become a refuge for things you don't want. Julian just showed you the refugium pump. He just showed you the refugium tubing. And these are things that on a long enough timeline, everything you grow in your tank becomes a pest, whether it's coralline algae, vermetid snails, calcareous incrustations. And there's another word for that in the public aquarium industry, or the public aquarium practice, and in shipbuilding. It's called biofouling. Biofouling, okay? So
it's also called things that interns clean.
You know, and the biofouling, if your refugium becomes biofouled, it's basically a refuge now for hair algae, derbesia, bryopsis, that aptasia you keep getting rid of your tank and shows up from nowhere, that's growing in the refuge of your tubes and your pumps and your refugium. Fish diseases, they also really love to hide that in the sand. So you can use all the prophylactic treatments you want, and as soon as the exhibit conditions kind of become better for the parasite, it just comes out of the refugium. So if you're doing a refugium, you really have to kind of fine tune it to the critters that you're trying to keep, just like Julian mentioned. If you want a refugium for pods, if you want a refugium for giant clams, if you want a refugium for corals, set up an environment for that. But when you put together a catch-all to try to perform all these miraculous functions, you really get the worst of all worlds. So yeah, that's what I got.
Okay. All right. Amazingly, Jake isn't as dumb as I remember. Good points, Jake. So we're going to open it up to the floor now. So if you have a question or a response or whatever, raise your hand. I'll come over, and you can ask your question for Julian, to Jake, and we'll get this debate started. Or we can just leave. I don't really care. I haven't eaten. I'm hungry. So we could do that too.
Oh, come on.
So I'll start it off because you guys are lame. Oh, we got one behind me? Where? What are you pointing at?
I'm just pointing at you.
Oh.
Trip you up.
It's all me.
Yeah. You're on the spot.
Well, I already thought of something. Hold on. I'm going to take it. So if we have this debate of what a refugium actually does, and Jake brought up what they're supposed to do off the Live Aquaria website, do we have any research that actually shows that it is a nutrient export, that phosphates are actually reduced, nitrates are actually reduced? It actually produces pods that are enough to make a difference in your tank. Is there anything besides the anecdotal crap that we all see that does that?
Yeah, that caveat of produces enough that it makes a difference in your tank, that's qualitative. I mean, you could measure that quantitatively, but it really gets down to scale. The effect of nutrient export, of producing enough food for the tank, is a scale factor. If the refugium is big enough, then of course it does that. As far as the literature studying that,
Well, that could be a water volume thing. If you have a million gallon sump on your 10-gallon aquarium,
right,
of course that's going to make a big difference.
Yes.
But is that actually going to help if you have a 20-gallon tank and a 20-gallon refugium? Yeah. Or just a 20-gallon tank without a refugium.
I think Julian's got a good point, because you have to qualify what is enough. You know, enough to be worthwhile investment. Right. And so in the day, we threw everything we knew about coral reef ecosystems at the problem of having a reef aquarium, because we didn't understand the processes. And the refugium was supposed to fill in all the gaps. And like he said, is it worthwhile to set up an aquarium if you're trying to get live food or trying to get some nutrient export? And I just really think that nowadays we have other very specific processes to address those needs versus having this magical mystery box that in theory produces pods and exports nutrients and all these other things.
Yeah, I would just say I would refer you to Walter Ade's books for the data on the stabilizing the pH and oxygen.
Is Walter Ade here? No, those books are long and boring. So
I know. There you go. But if you were looking for somebody who actually tested and looked at nutrient, I remember Ron Schimmick looked at nutrient export by Calerpa, and he kind of found that the rate of export wasn't as good as people were imagining. But I think that was also maybe not a complete study, because you have some refugia where the Calerpa or Chetomorpha grows like crazy, and you can be throwing, and then others where it's relatively stable and slower growing, and there are factors that affect it, and that would be true of any refugium.
On that same note, Julian did say something that aggravated me a little bit.
Here we go.
My goal.
Because there's so many people who have been duped into thinking that they can plop a few mangroves in their refugium and without proper lighting, that this mangrove is, it's a tree, it sucks up a lot of nutrients. You think, all right, hypothetically, it's going to remove a lot of nutrients.
Yeah.
But once again, it goes back to the point, is the investment worth the return, right? Yeah. So if you really want to have a mangrove export, nutrient export filter, you have to be lucky like Julian and have your refugium out, outside in full sunlight with 100 to 200 mangroves in about 4 square feet. But more often than not, people who
most people
follow some of these refugium principles with a mangrove, they pop a couple mangrove pods in the side of their tank and they get a few leaves out of it, but there's no real nutrient export.
So Julian, reaction.
It goes back to, is it a worthwhile investment? Almost done. If you set up a specific tank just for your mangroves, give it a 500-watt halide, and really take care of those mangroves, yes, it's going to export some nutrients. But all that effort you put into setting up that mangrove exporting nutrient export system, you could have just done some water changes, and you'd save a lot of more money on your power bill.
That's true. Yeah, it's a matter of execution, how you do it. I mean, I've been promoting the mangroves all these years. I've pointed out, first of all, throwing a couple of pods in there is not going to make a dent in the nutrient levels in the tank. It just isn't. The sand bed that you put them in is going to have a more measurable effect. With regard to, is it worth the investment? I think for mangroves, for most people who don't have the fortune of living in Florida and having mangroves available right in your backyard, the investment is a long-term investment. You can just put one or two, if you're successful with these mangroves and growing them. Once they grow into a substantial size, they do have a measurable impact on the nutrient levels.
Does a refugium increase or decrease the efficiency of protein?
I almost got to you in time.
Yeah.
You gotta remember. Remember, I'm a cripple.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna get to you too quickly, okay? So, Martin, patience. You've had patience your entire life, man.
Does a refugium increase or decrease the efficiency of protein skimming?
Okay, shall I take that first?
I'll go first.
Go ahead.
If we're talking about just protein skimming, I guess there would be an argument to be made that a properly set up refugium that is spitting out a lot of pods and pod poop is going to be a form of particulate matter that's more easily skimmed out. But I don't know if the benefit to protein skimming and the nutrient export that goes with that is going to be worthwhile compared to some of the nutrient sink that happens in the refugium area.
Okay, that's true, but I'll tell you firsthand personal experience. Okay? It depends on whether the refugium is based on a deep sand bed or based on algae. If it's based on a deep sand bed, the skimmer dies. Sand wins. If it's based on algae, you may get a benefit because the algae leach organic substances in the water that are skimmable. Okay, now the algae themselves also remove dissolved inorganic nutrients. That doesn't really affect the protein skimmer so much. It's the it's their leachate, the algal leachate, that can enhance skimming and thereby pull other things out along with it. So the answer is yes and no, and it depends on what, and that's from personal experience. I've seen it. So if you're going to set up a refugium with Joubert's method, and you had a skimmer before, let's say you were measuring, I was taking out 30 mils of skimmate a day, or 50 mils, whatever it was on a small system, employing that refugium, you'll see that drop dramatically. The skimmer will stop.
I think you're wrong on both counts.
Okay. Yeah. It's personal experience.
All have reef tanks here. And yeah. We remember 15 years ago, everybody started stripping their bioballs because the bioballs were out-competing the protein skimmer and converting our wastes from ammonia to nitrate really fast.
Yeah.
We know this, right? So on both fronts, The sand bed is acting as a nutrient sink, and there's particles going into it. So in a way, it's cock-locking the protein skimmer from performing properly.
It's a good point.
We don't use that language here, Jake.
Now,
and along the same lines with the macroalgae or the microalgae, they are leaching some compounds. But what if you give the protein skimmer those raw organics before they break down? In all cases, hypothetically, the protein skimmer would work better.
See, but what the sand bed does, you notice no pause. The sand bed deals with the nitrogenous waste very well, and it allows conversion of nitrate to nitrogen gas and thereby eliminate it. Phosphate it doesn't deal with very well. So if you have a sand bed and you don't have some method of dealing with the phosphate long term, growing algae, of course, can help by exporting phosphate. That can be an issue. Yeah, and the skimmer, if you're impeding the effect of the skimmer, then a skimmer is quite good at exporting phosphate. So it's something to consider in your calculus, in your calculation of the design of the system. If I'm depending on a sand bed, what am I doing about phosphate? Nitrate is not an issue. So I wanted to
Good question here.
Yeah, very good. There was one.
So can't we think of the refugium as something of a safety net? It's a dynamic system, and I agree with you, Jake, that if there's a problem with nutrients, that you could do a water change, you can change your GFO, you can change your carbon, but half the time we get lazy with that a bit, and when that happens, you can often see, say, a caulerpa bed will rapidly start to grow because there's a nutrient increase. So I think of it as something of a safety net that, why wouldn't I want it?
Well, you just said it yourself. You said it's a dynamic system. It's a dynamic aquarium system. It's a separate dynamic aquarium system. So you're adding a layer of complexity to an aquarium that's already pretty complicated. I really believe in simplifying reef tanks, as much water as possible, and as much coral as possible, and everything else is kind of secondary. A good protein skimmer, good biological bacterial activity really does the job. But you say you're stating that a refugium is a safety net, where I see it more as a time bomb. It's a safety net for a little while, right? But if you get a little bit lazier, that algae starts to die, it starts to suffocate your sand bed. So that safety net gives you a little bit of leeway, but it's at a huge risk, in my opinion.
I've taken the position that over the past 20, 30 years that I've been writing, that I would prefer a large, clean sump tank over a refugium.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Most people's refugiums become
score for me? What do you want to say to that, Julian?
Yeah.
It was a comment.
Turn it off. So anyway.
Hey, you gotta pick the first guy to ask the question. Yeah.
What?
Mr. Reefapalooza, right here.
What about you?
Real quickly though, I remember Julian's way back when you had a 5-gallon show tank and a 15-gallon refugium. Worked fine. I liked it. But how about pH stabilization? You know, you've got reverse daylight.
Right.
Something like this. Is that good or bad? Are we just kidding ourselves, you know, with oxygen and carbon, et cetera?
On the pH stabilization front, I know Jake will say you could be dosing kalkwasser, and he'd be right. So, you know, there's a lot of ways to skin the cat. It gets down to whether you want to do it one way or another on pH stabilization. Oxygen, clearly if you're using a protein skimmer and high turnover, especially going over an overflow, the main way of oxygenating aquarium is that surface skimming overflow. You can keep your tank adequately oxygenated, but having a reverse daylight lit refugium does give you that supersaturation level of oxygen at night. As to what benefit that affords you, nobody really has a quantitative answer, okay? That's a feel-good thing. It's really a qualitative thing.
I will tell you that there is direct evidence, scientific research papers, that shows that corals actually can grow slower in higher oxygen water. And we think that oxygen is a good thing, but too much of a good thing actually can prevent and slow down some processes.
Yeah, that's when they're illuminated, though.
You're saying you should have a daylight cycle?
Yeah. I got to say that using those papers for that argument, nah. Because
we think of oxygen as being a good thing. When we say oxygenation, it's a feel-good thing. It's like, oh, my water's oxygenated. But unless you have a lot of fish in a really covered-up aquarium, the overflow does most of what you're going to need it to do.
Yeah.
And my whole beef, I guess, with the refugium is relying on a dynamic system, a dynamic aquarium system, to roundabout change things in your aquarium. Just like he said, if you want to control pH, you want to keep your pH up, dose kalkwasser. You want to increase oxygenation, increase the air agitation, or just add an air stone. You know, I like direct processes for addressing those things, not setting up a light on a separate tank to light algae that needs to pull CO2 from the tank to actually oxygenate the water. You know, I just want a little bit more direct
but
process.
But don't you see the earth rotates and it's illuminated on one side and it's dark on the other? Hey, this is God's plan, right? And I hope you understand the tongue-in-cheek way that I'm saying that, because I certainly do not take aquarium husbandry to a religious level.
Right. Well, I have a good question. And my question is, you're both right.
That's a statement.
That's a statement.
That's really my tongue-in-cheek way of saying that. I don't have a question, but I want to get some good responses to my statement from you. Is the way I look at it is deciding what you want to do for maintenance. Like, I would much rather prefer an annual big cleanup on a nutrient sink refugium than the weekly taking apart of a skimmer to get the ultimate, you know, skimming capacity of it. I would rather be rooting through muck and vacuuming all that crap out of my sand bed once a year. Basically, I have a 5-year sand bed maintenance. That's why I go, you know, at least a fifth or a quarter of my sand bed, I have to pull all those nutrients out. It's a nutrient sink. Part of what a nutrient sink does is it pulls
if it
nutrients.
Was as simple as that,
you know, it's not as simple, but you know, it's like it's kind of, you know, I'm going, I don't have scientific, you know, things to back me up. I just, you know, I grow coral, so the way that I
no, Justin, we know you are. I trust your experience.
Yeah, but so but what
me,
I like
let
to
me
do
follow up
is,
on your statement though. I'd like to address it.
So my statement is, I prefer I prefer, just for myself, I know that other people, and I see amazing systems with skimming. It's like what Julian said, there's many ways to skin a cat. I just prefer to skin my cat with a lot of muck and dirtiness, and it's just the maintenance I prefer. But I think that there's other real, like, however, I've been in other environments, like working in large wholesale, you know, with moving a lot of animals through, refugiums are really impractical. And I started doing that, and I got rid of all of them, and I did all bio pellets and huge protein skimmers.
So okay, I think we're getting a little bit outside of the range, you know, because we can't really discuss, like, small home tank, a huge tank.
All right, this is starting to remind me of when I go to elementary school. They're like, any questions about this fish I brought? My dad one time had this fish, and
I want to hear what Lake Sai has to say.
It's okay, Justin. I love you. And good statement. But if we wanted your opinion, we'd have you up top.
Smack out. Whoosh.
Smitten.
I'm Lake Sai.
I should say Lake.
Okay. I'm the one who invented the ecosystem filter in 1989, and I've been experimenting until now a lot. And throughout the time, and this is what people confuse what I'm doing, they look at the ecosystem aquarium as just a refugium. So what the definition that Julian's give is correct is in term of refugium, but in what we do, ecosystem filter, it's a filter. It's a refugium, just one part of it. And you can have phytoplankton, couple part. We don't have to do all of that. We have all of that's great in your system. And you don't need protein skimmer. When we do the experiment, this is what I find, that if you use protein skimmer 6 hours a day, it will create a lot of growth for SBS tank. A lot of color, and but if you do is only like LPS soft world, you don't really need a protein skimmer. And if you run protein skimmer all the time with a filter, it's become counterproductive.
I think that the point that Link Sai is making is that there's a lot of very good aquarium concepts and ideas, and certain things get muddied and blended in ways that are not necessarily suitable. You know, I talked about the merger of the algae scrubber, the refugium, and the deep sand bed. And that's what the refugium has become lately. And so just, you know, if you're new or intermediate, you know, and you want a specific function to come from your refugium, just make sure you research what it is you wanted to do and what's the best way to accomplish that.
The whole thing about what I'm doing is that we're trying to find a simple way to keep marine aquarium so more people can get in, okay, to create our business. And the reason is a lot of people give up this hobby in the first year, 65% or so in the first year. It's not because of success. It's because of failure. And that's what I'm trying to do to raise that percentage up.
Let's take one more question and wrap it up so we're not here all day. I think we have a speaker soon.
Yeah.
You have a question?
Yeah.
Let me hear it first.
It's about
anything else? Okay.
I just had a question. We're talking about the design of refugiums, and I haven't heard anyone mention anything about the sump, the blender, otherwise known as the sump pump. And if we're looking at a focus for feeding our tanks and pods, is there a percentage of pods that actually make it through your sump pump, or? I don't know how many people here have airlift pumps. I don't think we do, or refugiums above the tank. So I'm just curious if there's some pumps out there that are better than others for this stuff.
That's a question.
Hey. Yeah. Okay, well, what you're touching on is something Walter Ady talked about a lot with dynamic aquaria. And although you can do some experiments and show the damage to plankton that a centrifugal pump can do, and I would agree that you would not manage a plankton culture system with a centrifugal pump, the quantities of plankton that are produced by refugium aren't on the levels of plankton culture system usually. And a lot of plankton can pass through a pump unharmed. There's a whole lot of space between the blades, and although there's shearing pressure and whatnot in the pump housing, heck, there, fish can be pumped through a centrifugal pump. So, yeah, if you look at the fish farms, sometimes they transfer fishes with some centrifugal pumps. You know, not with knife-like blades.
That's actually a really good question to end on.
Yeah.
Because my whole point is not even necessarily about refugiums. My whole point is about using critical thinking when you're setting up your tank, when you're running your tank, and the discrepancies that exist between what happens hypothetically and what happens in real life. So hypothetically, if you have plankton coming from your refugium and they go through a centrifugal pump, it's all gone. It's all dead. That's it.
In reality,
practice,
that's not true.
A lot of stuff gets through, and you know, we just need kind of to shore up the principles on paper versus the real life results. And then to finish up that question, Pantaray is actually here, and they have a lot of different water pumps. And they have a pump that's in the works called the Hydro Tube, which is basically a motor with a screw within a tube. So if you want a really plankton-friendly pump, Hydro Tube, they might have one at Pantaray, first of its kind, here at MACNA. So. Mm-hmm.
So you want to wrap this up? We're done?
Yeah, we got the next speaker coming up.
Okay.
All right. So by a raise of hands, who thinks Jake won?
Woo!
All right.
What's that?
I did a quick count. Julian?
It's even. It's a tie.
To me, it looked like a tie, so I'll take the money.
Thanks
so just come on up. Everybody give me $1.
That was very fun. Hopefully we can do this again. Or other people. Yeah.